-5 wind chill and some, yeah, so bundle up, watch the animals outside. So I know I mentioned it Sunday, but 2016 has been a rough year. Is that the nice way to say that?
Yeah.
And things are about ready to change. And they're about ready to change quickly and completely. And the Lord has just shown me that 2017 is just a year of reaping. Our blessings will come so fast, we won't, right now I feel like the prayer requests are heavy and serious, and the needs are great and real. And these attacks of the enemy is freaking out because he knows things are changing and his hour is up. And I know that it's not necessarily about the calendar, it's not about the new year and the calendar and all that, but the season is changing. There's a time and a season for everything. We just read, that we're called for such a time as this. And those who have been able to hang on, those who have been able to remain faithful, those who have followed through and not stopped running the race, there's no finish line in our race. There's eternity. There's no beginning and no end to our life in Christ. And whatever the Lord has promised you, whatever your heart longs to see in your family, in your own lives, hang on, because things are about ready to change, and the blessings are coming, the healings are coming, the prosperity is coming, whatever the Lord has been, I feel like it's the archangel, I'm on my way, he's saying, I am on my way, I was deterred for 21 days, I heard your prayer, and I'm on my way. The answer is yay and amen, it already is, but we just have to hang on,
yes,
till the principalities and the powers in this city, in this stronghold, are done. And their days are numbered. I know it to the depths of my soul. And so I encourage you to just remember and stir up the promises. Remember and stir up the gifts. And while we wait, we praise. We praise the Lord, for he is worthy. Even through the darkest times, even through the roughest things that we go through in this life, his promises, his faithfulness does not change. He can change things in a moment that we can't even fathom in our human minds. He is the God of the impossible.
Amen.
You know, Michael and I had one of our last counseling sessions tonight, and how many years have I been coming to this church? I've been married 10 years. And I prayed the whole 10 years to have a husband that loved this place as much as I did. And I do, and it took something horrible. We went through some really, 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 really rough times, and I let go. I let go, and I thought we were done. But God had plans. And as soon as I opened my heart to God, he restored all things and made it better than it ever was. And that's just one thing that God has done in the darkest of hours. So no matter how dark, no matter how hard, no matter how painful, hang on. I can't, what Tammy was sharing from that book about the night and then the day. It's not day and then night. It is the night and then the day. He comes with the morning. If we could just hang on through the night and watch for him. I love the Lord of the Rings. Look to the east. The sun rising of the third day. Look to the east and I will be there. That is the Lord. He's telling us, just hang on. And know that I have it under control. I have heard your prayers. They are done in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Just hang
thank
on.
You, Lord,
in Jesus'
God.
Name.
Thank you, Lord.
So, anybody have any prayer requests or any testimonies tonight that I want to share?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I have quite a testimony. I didn't know Joe's had some experience and stuff. I had a dog with a sprained neck, and he got his hands warm. And just massage the neck and spread the muscle out for long, that neck's almost practically healed. And here it is, I knew the dog had a sprained neck, and God had to show me something through Joe doing that. Now if I massage him a little bit every day, it's going to get stronger. And eventually it probably go back to normal, but the vet probably could have told me the same thing. And I found out when Joe showed me that, all of a sudden, I seen different, the way the dog acted. So if it's going to be that simple, the Lord's going to show us, then we're just going to have to open our eyes and to observe.
Amen.
Amen. Thank
yeah.
you, Lord.
Yeah, Mike.
Just the Lord of now, the Lord of provision, came through again. Well, I usually, well, for the last 12 years, I've been getting supplied with firewood. And one of my customers came by who owns a tree service and stuff like that, came by last week, and I took care of him, wanted some product and stuff, and told him I'm looking for, you know, next year's firewood, 2017, 2018 firewood. And he called me Monday to get something else, and says, oh, I'll have a load down by the airport, and I'm going to be taking it up to Ankeny, whatever else like that. And I talked to him, I says, well, you just stop at where I work on Delaware there. And he met me there at 6 o'clock on Monday night. I wound up with 3 pickup loads of maple. It's home. I haven't unloaded the third load yet. I was rolling in my house with the third load at 9 o'clock. But I asked, and the Lord provided. Boom, like that. So it's been great. It's been good. I thank the Lord for that. And so many other blessings coming forth, you know, this week on trying to sell wood products and stuff like that. I get a little lean, and I was just, what's up, Lord? You know, am I doing something wrong? And people are saying, well, why don't you drop your prices and stuff like that? No. I had a standard, and there were people standing with me with that standard and stuff, and got a couple calls. I got a specific call tonight for an unfinished manger, and then I know you mentioned the lower half that you're after, and then Jody's snowman's downstairs, and that was cool. And then Jody, I talked to her earlier, asked her how her mom was doing, because she said she wasn't going to be able to come tonight because her mom had tests today. Well, the test they took today, they couldn't find anything, so there's more confirmation, so give glory to God. And she has to go back for, I think, her kidney and her bladder to be checked out and stuff like that. And then again, there's nothing there. She's healed. So
praise the Lord.
Praise God for the healing for Jody's mom.
Yes, amen.
Thank
yes.
you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yeah.
I didn't see the whole thing, but there's been another multiple shooting in Georgia, I believe it was. 2 officers, one was killed, and one was in serious condition in the hospital. And I didn't know, I didn't hear all the rest of it, but we need to be praying for that entire situation as well.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
For the officers and their families, as well as any other innocents that may have been affected by it.
Yeah.
And the police officers and the drug investigations, Des Moines, have been in the middle of that. It's horrible.
Yeah.
I can't. Just get it open up.
And honoring our vets, especially those that were at the Pearl Harbor attack.
Mm-hmm.
There are still
yeah.
several of them cruising around, just explaining the situation. Those who truly fought for our freedom, and those
mm-hmm.
that are in our country just flaunting it, like it's
mm-hmm.
no big deal.
Mm-hmm.
What the reality come to them.
Amen. Yeah, Pearl Harbor Day today. Yeah. It takes tragedy sometimes to find the true heart.
Yeah.
You know? And it's unfortunate, but
Amen.
We have many brave men and women
yeah.
in this nation.
Amen.
Yeah. Anybody else? Well, let's go to the Lord tonight. Heavenly Father,
thank
we just
Jesus.
Invite you
praise
into this
God.
House tonight, Lord. We've
bless
come.
You tonight.
We've come to gather together, Lord, in your name, in your house, Lord. This house of prayer.
Lord, for every need, this is my share.
The body gathers together to lift the needs up to you, Lord. Hear our petitions tonight, Lord. You know the needs of every member of this body, Lord. We thank you that Jody's mother is healed. We thank you that the symptoms are stopped right now in Jesus' name. We ask you to touch those affected by the shootings today in Georgia, Lord. We ask you to minister to the family members that have lost loved ones, those that are injured. We ask you to minister to the heart of this nation, Lord. Protect the men and women who serve, Lord, in uniform, Lord, to protect, who've given their lives to protect those in this nation, Lord. And whatever is at the heart of this, Lord, we know who is at the heart of it, but this anger, this hatred, let it be stopped. Let it be turned, Lord, into love and peace, Lord.
Lord,
nation, Lord. Heal the heart of this nation, Lord. The anger and the hatred be set aside, Lord. Let us remember that we are one nation under God, indivisible.
Lord.
The United States of America. Let the division be set aside. Give the people of this nation a vision and a hope for the future.
Lord.
Thank you that you are our hope, Lord, that you are our future, Lord. We put our trust in you.
Yes.
And though the battle rages all around us, Lord, though it seems like the dark night lasts a long time sometimes, Lord, we will wait and we will look to you, Lord. For we know you change everything, Lord. We know that you will never leave us and never forsake us, Lord. We know that all of your promises are yes and amen. Let the sun rise again in this nation. Let the sun rise in this nation, Lord. As we sit on the eastern gate of this city, Lord, we look to you. We put our hope and our trust in you, Son of God and Son of Man. Jesus Christ, the name above all names, Creator of heaven and earth, Redeemer of man. Lord, you have conquered death, hell, and the grave. What is left for us to fear? We thank you for the blessings that have come in this year. We thank you as the battles rage around us. We thank you for the victory that we know is ours in you, Lord. And while we wait, Lord, while we wait, we praise you. We lift up your name, Jesus. You are such a good, good, good Father. Meet with us tonight, Lord. And those who can't be here, Lord, minister to them in their homes, every member of this body, Lord. And continue to reach out and draw in those who are searching, those who are hurting, those who are longing for something more, those who are questioning as we celebrate the Christmas season, what is it all about? We know, Lord, we know you have revealed yourself to us, but there are those who don't know you. Reveal yourself, Lord, through the brothers and sisters in this body. Reveal yourself that they might know you and they might know your great love for them. Be with us in this service as we worship together and as we receive your word together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. If you brought a cell phone tonight, please remember to silence the ringer or turn it off. Amen. This Friday.
Focus on him. This is the season. This is the time. So, just going to gather together, seek him, pray for America, pray for Israel, pray for those that are coming that are in need of anything. Just going to lay their hands. Set people free who desire to come and be set free. Time of communion, fellowship, and love on the Lord.
Amen. Right, let's speak the word together tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you, Lord? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. Lord. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes and devour for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Ron, would you please come take the offering tonight?
Soon coming King, the Lord of Lords and King of Kings.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this nation and its people and the effect that it can have around the world. You, Lord, are the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the only true ruler of heaven and earth and all that is in it. And we give you the thanks and the praise for it, Lord. We thank you today, Lord, for what is going to manifest in the upcoming year.
Yes,
in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Mike, Suzanne, and James. Good work. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, the way the church behaves sometimes, I'm talking about the religious way of doing things, kind of reminds me of the guy that said that our cow wouldn't give milk, so we sold him. Our cow wouldn't give milk, so we sold him. Our cow wouldn't give milk, so we sold him. Thank you, James. I could have used a little drum roll there.
Utterly amazing.
You know, we're trying to produce something. Amen. Thank you very much. Thank you. You're too kind.
Speech.
But you know what I'm saying. You know, we're trying to do things that we can't do. Only God can do it. We need to put our confidence in Him. And our trust in Him, and I do believe that that's what's happening. You know, we're seeing more and more of the word of grace, and the reason for the word of grace is that it makes us depend on faith in God's finished work instead of us depending on us trying to measure up to some standard that is impossible for us to reach. And as long as we're operating in that realm, we can never get the promises manifest because it only comes through His goodness and His grace. And so I think that really that there's a, God has set the stage for the miraculous to be released in our lives, amen, so that everyone, there'll be no question, there'll be no argument about where it came from and how it got here. Hallelujah. It'll be Him and Him only. Praise the Lord. And to Him be all the glory. Praise God. Amen. All right, so we're going to go right to the Word of God tonight. And I want to start in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. Everything about the kingdom of God is about faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. And so we have to get our attention focused on Jesus and our confidence in Him. Amen. So in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, familiar, we all know the scripture, says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Okay? Let's go to Acts chapter 13, and we'll read verses 38 through 41. Acts 13, verses 38 through 41. And I plan on being brief tonight, because it's really cold out there, and you all need to get home and snuggle up. Get warm, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses. Beware, therefore, lest that come upon you which is spoken in the prophets. Behold, ye despisers, and wonder, and perish. For I work a work in your days, a work which ye shall in no wise believe, though a man declared unto you. I believe that's the year 2017. I think that's what we're talking about. That if you can back it up, Mike, to verses 38 and 39 again. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins, and by him all that believe are justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. Now it reminds me, and then that takes us right into the, if we can operate here, he's going to do a work. And it's interesting to me that he says, I will do a work. God is going to do something. When we get this settled, then God will do something that people cannot even believe. It'll be beyond their wildest expectations. It'll be kind of the exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Yes. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And it kind of reminds me, this whole idea is like the classic Jewish mother joke, you know. She gives her son, Marvin, two shirts as a present. And finally, one day, Marvin wears the first shirt, or one shirt, for the first time. And she looks at him, and sadly, she says, the other one you didn't like? I mean, there's no way to win, right? So, and that's kind of the way the law is. Just no matter what you do, it's not going to be enough. You're not going to satisfy. You're not going to make it happen the way only God can make it happen. Praise God. So, the fact that the law can't be kept perfectly except by Jesus, and that very fact throws us back to faith itself. If we understand that, it forces us into the realm of faith. It keeps us dissatisfied with our efforts, with our works, to satisfy God's requirement for righteousness. It forces us then to a place of faith. The law was meant for that very purpose, to force us to Christ and to faith in Him. And it's so bizarre when you think about it, how we've made it about everything other than that, and then wonder why the manifestation is so inconsistent.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So, you see, the goal of Christian faith isn't, and has never been, certainty. That's what the law did. It gave you a strict set of rules and regulations, and this is the way it is. It gave you some certainty, but it gave you no manifestation.
Right.
And so true Christianity, was never given to us in a way that we could have certainty about anything. Otherwise, it wouldn't be faith.
Right.
Amen? So the scripture defines faith in terms of knowledge and trust, not certainty. Right? Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12. As human beings, we all want certainty, you know.
Right.
I could just tell you, for an example, as Mike is pulling that scripture up, you know, the times I took algebra, and I took it multiple times. I took it twice in high school, and I took it once in college. But if I had a dollar for every time algebra has helped me, I'd have N dollars. For those of you who took algebra, hallelujah. So I'm saying, you know, we have to understand that God is trying to get us to do something that we can't do.
Right.
And the only way it can be done is by faith in Him and what He has done. He's the equation. He's the key to every answer.
Yes.
To every problem, every situation. He's the answer.
Yes.
And the only answer. Praise God.
Amen.
Now, for the which cause I also suffer these things, nevertheless I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that He's able to keep that which I have committed unto Him against that day. All we did is make a commitment, and He does the keeping of everything, right?
Yes.
I know who I believe, and I'm not ashamed. And I'm persuaded that He is able to keep that which I have committed unto Him against that day. Hallelujah. Now, what I'm saying is there's no insurance against risk. Praise the Lord. We are promised, if we make commitment to the Lord and we trust our lives to Him, we're going to be led step by step into a fuller understanding of truth.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. God doesn't expect certainty. God asks for faith.
Yes.
Praise God. Hebrews chapter 11. Again, let's look at verses 1 through 3 this time. Hebrews 11, verses 1 through 3. I told Sally this last night. This guy said he had a dream, horrible dream. He said, I had this horrible dream last night, and the guy that he was telling this to said, yeah, I know. I saw you with her.
Ooh. Ouch.
Oh, I love these these politically incorrect amen stories. So this is where my life lives. Well, it's like the guy said that I had this beautiful dream last night. I dreamed I went to heaven. And the guy said, "What woke you up?" And he said, "The heat." Oh, next time, James, I want you to stay up here with me. Praise the Lord. So he says, "Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear." Let me read that again. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, by faith, the elders obtained a good report. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed. Now, the elders didn't receive a good report because of the keeping of the law. They received a good report because they operated by faith. So, through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So, my understanding is going to grow, but it's never going to be complete.
Right.
So the way they operated in faith was that it wasn't all of the rules and the rituals that they had to keep, because they failed. That was the reason for the sacrifice. But they made the keeping of the rules the priority and the sacrifice a secondary issue, when in fact it was all about the sacrifice.
Right.
Those who trusted in the sacrifice for the atoning of their sins, or for the holding back the judgment of God's judgment on them, that God called faith, just as our faith is in Christ and not in ourselves. But we've done the same thing. The church has done the same thing. We've made it about the rule keeping and not in the sacrifice. The sacrifice is complete.
Yes.
It's once and for all, he said. Yes. Amen. And what the law could never do, he did. By one sacrifice, praise the Lord. And so that has to be our focus. So we're not going to understand necessarily all things. Our understanding will grow. And as Suzanne said, there's no finish line here.
Right.
You don't ever arrive. Paul said, "Not as though I have arrived, but I press toward the mark, toward the high calling of God in Christ Jesus."
Yes.
Amen. In this understanding of faith. So our understanding will grow, but it just won't ever be finished. It won't ever be completed. Because, in fact, if you think about it, how could it be?
Right.
How are we ever going to plumb the depths of God? I mean, how are we ever going to get to the end of God and all the knowledge of God?
Right.
We can't, but we can continue to know more and grow deeper and deeper into that relationship. And I think that's what's happening with prophetic words. That's what's happening with the declaration of the word of God and so on and so forth. There's people stepping out and declaring, being more like God, therefore revealing more of God, not only to other people, but to ourselves in the process. Amen? So, look at Galatians chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. That no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident, for the just shall live by faith. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. So the law is not of faith, but the man that lives by the law is going to be bound by that law.
Mm-hmm.
So what he's saying is, the law provides certainty, but it doesn't provide salvation.
Right.
It'll give you all the rules and the regulations. It'll make it clear to you what's demanded of you, what you have to do, but you can't do it.
Right.
So it'll tell you what you have to do to be saved, but it won't give you any salvation.
Jeez.
Praise the Lord. So, my need to trust is never going to end. My ultimate security will never be in what I know, but it'll be in who I know.
Amen.
Praise God. 2 Timothy 1, verse 12 again. "For the which cause I also suffer these things, nevertheless I'm not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day," right? So he says, our hope, in other words, our imagination can be the catalyst for faith that the Spirit then can use to create something out of nothing. Does that make sense to you? That's what he's talking about. That's what he's talking about in Hebrews 11, and that's what Timothy is speaking about right here. Our hope, or what we can imagine, because God says, I'm going to do something that you haven't even thought of yet, that you can't even imagine yet. So think big, dream big, pray big, believe big, right? Because you're not going to outdo it. You're not going to get him to a place where he goes, whoa, that's, we've reached the limit here. We can't get there.
Right.
No. As high as we can go, he's still higher.
Amen.
So our hope, our imagination is what God wants to use as the catalyst for faith.
Amen.
So that then the Spirit can use that to create something out of nothing. That gives me goosebumps. That tells me what God is saying to us is, look, the ball's in your court.
Right.
What can you believe? What can you have faith for? Because that's what I'll do. That's why it's so important that we get past the religious deals and rituals and so on and so forth and get down to the real nitty-gritty, which is believe God for the miraculous, and we will have it. That will be what manifests. Because he's going to do this out of nothing anyhow in terms of what we can see in the natural.
Right.
So we got to have an imagination that is established in God and in his word and what God says that he will do and can do. Amen?
Amen.
So the assurance of things hoped for. The conviction or the evidence of things not seen. That's what the Spirit is being released to do. That's what hoping or an imagination creates this catalyst for the Spirit to do. Praise the Lord. So we stimulate faith in a God that we can't see, but a God that can be trusted.
Yes.
Amen. Think about it. The very essence of what faith is established in that reality. We look at things that are not as though they are.
Right.
If we can believe in a God that we can't see, have never seen,
yes,
then why can't we believe for what that invisible God can do?
That's right.
That's the emphasis, and that is the very basis of everything. So that's what he's saying. Without faith, it's impossible to please God.
Right?
Right.
Because
without faith, you can't even believe that there is a God.
That's right.
Because you don't see him. He's invisible. But how many of you know, what, since you've come to faith, not only is God real to you, but God has actually spoken to you.
Amen.
God has made himself tangible,
amen,
although invisible. Hey, he's manifesting.
Yep.
And that's what he's trying to get us to understand. We may never have certainty about any of this, but we can certainly have manifestation.
Amen.
We can have information and more knowledge, which leads us to dream bigger, have greater imagination, so that we release the Spirit, we release this catalyst for the Spirit then to manifest the invisible.
Yes, Lord.
Yeah.
Right?
Thank you.
Jesus, the Spirit, came in a man.
Come on.
Manifested. Why? Because God made a promise and the people prayed and believed that he would come.
Yes.
Not everybody believed it, but not everybody saw it, did they? Even though he looked them eye to eye.
Mm-hmm.
Praise God. So, John 16, verse 13. John 16, verse 13. Howbeit, when he... The Spirit of truth, because now this just fascinates me, but he says, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself. Now, we know the Spirit's invisible, right? For he won't speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come.
Come on.
Praise God. So what he's saying is, faith says, unless I believe, I won't understand. See, if you don't believe, he can't reveal anything to you.
Right.
But if you do believe, he'll reveal things and show you things that haven't even happened yet.
Right.
Not only will he reveal what the purpose of things that has happened or are happening, but he'll reveal to you things that have not ever even come on the scene yet.
Come on.
But that's what faith does. Faith tells me, I got to believe,
yes,
in order to understand.
There you go.
Praise God. All right. He says it's the substance of things hoped for, right? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. All right, look at Romans chapter 4, verses 17 and 18. Romans 4, 17 and 18. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. Now he's talking about Abraham, obviously. Before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope.
Yes.
That he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be.
Yes, Lord.
So that's where we find ourselves a lot of times. Hoping against hope.
Yeah.
Right.
Imagining bigger than what reality can make sense of, right? Mm-hmm. So he hopes against hope. Who against hope believed in hope.
Yeah.
Is the way it should be said. Mm-hmm. Who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken, according to what God had said.
Yeah.
Amen. So hope combine something tangible and concrete with an uncertain pathway or timeline for arrival or for manifestation.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
That's why without hope, we're done.
Right.
Right.
But you can hope even against hope.
Yes.
Right.
Amen. Because what we're doing is we're creating. See, if by faith, he says, these things come to pass, right? Faith is the substance of things hoped for.
Yes.
The evidence of things not seen. And all I said was just in another way that hope combines something tangible and concrete with an uncertain pathway. Now, he had something tangible and concrete, which was God's word.
Yes.
But he didn't have a pathway or a means by which he knew it could happen. So he had something tangible, but he had to take that tangible reality, in a sense, that word, that concrete evidence, and connect it to an uncertain pathway or a timeline for its arrival or its manifestation.
Yes.
That's what we do with every promise from God.
Thank you, Lord.
Too often, though, unlike Abraham, we give up. Or, like Abraham, we try to create the manifestation ourselves and screw everything up. And end up with our own little Ishmaels that we got to deal with then for the rest of our lives.
Right.
Amen. It's not a curse from God. It's just a reaping what you sow.
Yep.
Because we couldn't believe big enough.
Right.
We settle for something that actually becomes a curse in a lot of ways. Amen.
Yep.
Praise God. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. We don't need to know. See, that's what I mean. We don't have to have certainty. We just gotta believe. We don't need to know what the pathway is God's gonna use or the timeline in which he's gonna make it manifest, just like Suzanne was saying tonight. See, she prayed, but it didn't happen in what we would think of in a normal timeline. This is, I'm not just picking on Suzanne, I'm saying this is true of every one of us.
Right.
Because we have our own imagination, it's limited to what we think it ought to be, how soon it ought to happen, the way it ought to happen. How this promise from God is going to manifest. And if we don't hold on or exercise faith or keep hoping, amen, we never see the timeline come to its completion. We never get to see the manifestation.
Right.
Many times, though, I think that's the scripture that God's talking about when he says, you know, whatever the enemy meant for evil, I'll use for good.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that all things work together for good to them that love God.
Yes.
I'll make manifestation if you'll just hang on.
Yes.
Even if it looks like there's nothing ever going to happen, if you can just hang on,
yes,
manifestation has to come, even if it isn't, if it doesn't fit your timeline.
Right.
Yes.
Or the path that you think it ought to take. Praise
right.
God. So blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, which, according to his abundant mercy,
yes,
hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Yes.
All right? Drop down to verse 5. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. These are the last times. God has been wanting this revelation for a long time. Because
yes,
it's been the last time for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
It will be the last time, literally, when it's revealed. And how's it going to be revealed? In us.
Hallelujah.
We have something to say about the last days.
Uh-huh.
We have something to say about the return of the Lord.
Come on.
That's why he says no man knows the hour of the day.
Right.
Praise God. Living hope. And the contrast of sure and certain outcome.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. You want certainty? Trust the Lord.
Yes.
There you go.
Hope in what he has promised.
Yes.
That's the only certainty we're ever going to have.
Yes.
That if we don't quit believing, if we don't stop hoping, if we don't stop hoping against hope, the certainty is it shall come to pass, even as the Lord has said. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12.
1 Corinthians 13, verse 12.
See, see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know, even as also I am known. So the human struggle to see more clearly, to know more deeply, again, forces us to faith. Even, you know, the very essence of what we are and who we are as human beings, God created us this way, to want answers, to want to know more, to want to go deeper. But what does that do? It forces us to go to faith.
Yes.
It forces us into a situation where God can deal with us, where God can respond to us, where God can give us more, can tell us more,
yes,
can show us more.
Yes, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
So there's no fail-safe method of just doing things or formulas. They make us feel better. But God is beyond human control, so they don't produce anything. They just make us feel a little bit more like we're accomplishing something, but it really doesn't produce a thing. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
For example, John chapter 3, verse 8. The wind bloweth where it listeth. Now he is talking about the Spirit. Thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. So when the Spirit moves, do we exercise faith or do we just ask what's going on? You know what I'm saying? If the Spirit's moving, it's because the Spirit is expecting us to exercise faith, though, so that he can take that faith and produce something tangible and visible, so that he can give us, put us on the path, on that timeline that God has already established. But a lot of times what we've done is go, wow! Wasn't that exciting? But we never listened or moved beyond the moment of the sense of the presence of God without ever stopping long enough to hear what the Spirit is actually saying so that we can receive from God. God doesn't want to just tickle our fancy, so to speak.
Right.
He literally wants to manifest. He wants us to have tangible evidence and proof of his existence,
yes,
even though he's an invisible God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Philippians chapter 3, verses 3 through 9. Philippians 3, 3 through 9. For we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit. It's a circumcision of the heart, right? And rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. Circumcised the eighth day, the stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, and touching the law of Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith.
Amen.
So Paul understood this is all about faith, because he did all the other stuff that could be done,
right,
and didn't produce anything.
Right.
So Paul's reflecting the harder he tried to be righteous, the further from God that he was.
Mm-hmm.
So much so that when God showed up and knocked him off his horse, he didn't even know who it was. Now you would have thought with his pedigree, he would have known immediately. But what he's telling us is the more we try to do things by the flesh, not by faith, the further we actually are from God. Our struggle, our inadequate faith even, our hoping against hope, so to speak, draws us closer to God than any work of self-righteousness you can ever do. Any good deed, any nice work. Not that we shouldn't do those things, but those things do not bring us closer to God. The only thing that brings us closer to God is believing in the promise of God.
Yes.
That draws us to God. It touches the heart of God. It's a thing that God can't turn away from.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Okay, 2 Corinthians again. 2 Corinthians for the first time, I guess. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. This will be the last scripture. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So, to just wrap up, the end of our ability forces us to faith. That's what Paul's talking about. We should rejoice in our fleshly weakness, because that's the very thing that forces us into an encounter with God.
Amen.
On every level. Initially, when we get saved, what happens? We come to the end of ourselves. We realize we're screwed up. We can't get this thing fixed. We can't get our act together. We can't do enough to make everything right. The harder we try, like Paul, the harder we want to do right, and we want to make resolutions and stop doing this and not do that and do this. We're setting ourselves up for failure every time, and at some point we finally come to the end of ourselves and we say, I need a Savior. And the only way to have that Savior is to exercise faith. Everything in the kingdom of God works the same way.
Yes.
Amen.
Paul said it like this: O foolish Galatians, having begun in the Spirit or operating in faith, are you going to be so foolish now to try to do it in the flesh? Try to do it by your own effort, your own ability. Paul knew, because he's already told us, I tried that route and it doesn't work. What I found works is when I stop trying to do it myself and start trusting in what Jesus has done.
Amen.
It forces us to faith. And that gives us a discovery of what God is able to do in and for us that we could never do in and for ourselves.
Amen.
It's all. It's all about believing in Him. The only certainty in Christianity is, without faith, it's impossible to please Him.
Right.
Amen? Give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Thank you. Amen. God bless all of you. Stay warm. Stay safe. See you here Sunday, hopefully. God bless you.
Friday night?
Yes.
House of prayer. Praise God. God be blessed. Spirit will move. If we believe, praise God.